let's bring this man on because we were talking to him a few minutes ago and he said, okay, I don't want to wait too long because I got to lie down. Mr. Richard Lewis.
What an introduction. Not mine, the show. It was, Timothy Leary would have gone to Betty Ford if you watched that. So I want to congratulate whoever put that together.
That's Alan. Alan does all that. And yes, he does a fine job.
Yeah, well, I try to make it my point to be on. I haven't done a show in over a year because I've had a couple of back and shoulder surgeries, but this is my first. I try to do, even in, when I'm healthy, try to do as many shows that people are drinking, considering I'm a drug addict and an alcoholic.
Oh.
I like that. That's exciting. And I also like to be on with people who have helped my career for over 40 years and, or say 38. I don't want to age you. You've been one of the most important people in my career. So,
well, thank you. I appreciate that. And you came on our radio show many years ago, and we immediately clicked as just humans and friends and things right away. And you and I hung out. And whenever I'm in Los Angeles, I like to hang out with you because I just find you a fascinating person and one of the funniest people I've ever seen on stage. Marge,
how is your send my love to your wife and your daughter. How is your dog?
Dog Flynn is great. We have
had to talk you into getting a dog.
When I was in Los Angeles a few years ago, you had just gotten a dog and I thought you were the last person to get a dog and you could not be happier with this dog. And I thought, wow, I never thought I'd see this. And then we got a dog and I can't imagine my life without a dog now. Now, your dog died, right? Your first dog?
Yeah, thanks for reminding me. But then we got another one. But if either one of these girls were maybe 5'5 and wore heels, I would go to Paris with them and that would be the end of it. They listen to me. I talk to them. I tell them what movies I want to watch. They don't bitch. They lick me. It doesn't get any better.
It's all the stuff you love.
That you don't get in real life, mainly.
Okay, I have to correct something. I thought you were on Curb Your Enthusiasm this Sunday, but you're on in December.
Early December. I only did one episode this year, and I think it's the second or third week in December. And it was great that I even was able to go there for a week and work. But, you know, it'll be a great year, and I'm just, you know, selfishly hope he comes back next year. But it's been on since 2000, so I'm a pretty grateful actor. So, if he doesn't come back, it's been a great run. So,
Well, he has usually put you in at least half the episodes every year. But because, let's address the 800-pound medical bill in the room. You have shoulder and back issues that started how long ago?
They started when I was about two. And my family didn't want to help me. So I had to ask strangers in the street to diagnose me. It's a horrible story. And that's basically true. But I have a bad back. Everyone has a bad back. I hate to scare anybody. But when you get after your 60s and early 70s, your discs start to melt and you start shrinking. It's like that. What's that movie with the guy? He starts as a man, then he ends like a baby. I didn't see it.
Benjamin Button.
Oh, yeah, I could. The name got me nauseated.
Okay.
But I became that. I mean, when I went to the hospital, they weigh you and they put you and they take your height. And I went, this can't be. I used to be 5'9½. No, Mr. Lewis, you're 5'1". My wife almost left me. I'm not 5'1", but you do shrink, and that sucks.
You said earlier, you said you were 3-1.
I had a back operation, and this is the wildest trip, man. My shoulder was so bad, they said, and I never heard of this before. The doctor says, and he's like, the guy. Everyone says that out here. You have a bad knuckle? I got the knuckle guy. You got it. And everyone thinks they go to the best. Your nostril hair? I got a nostril hair guy. He won't. So I had to go to a reverse shoulder guy. He put my shoulder in backwards. That was my only option. So for the first month, if I wanted to, let's say I wanted to take some Chinese food. I don't know why I mentioned Chinese food, but I would take the food and then I would eat it, pouring it over my head and my hair because your shoulder's backwards. Everything was all screwed up. But it helped our relationship, Joyce and my wife and I, because when I got backwards, I became saner. For some reason, it helped me emotionally. But I'm going to be fine. I'm getting much better. But this is the first show I've done in a year. That's why I'm wearing sunglasses, because I'm, you know, I'm too embarrassed to feel like myself yet. But I'll be back.
Is this health issue related to when you played football at Kent State?
Ohio State.
You went to Ohio State.
Yeah, Ohio State, which is ranked number 4 in the country, but and they'll win tomorrow. But you know, I'm a big Buckeye, and you know, they always, I email everybody from Ohio State. It was the best time of my life. I mean, I went there in the, you know, the late 60s, rock and roll. I mean, it was horrible. The Vietnam thing was going down for many years before and after, but the rock and roll and the free love and you're drinking. I don't even remember what I did, but I'm alive. I actually stopped drinking and doing drugs knowing that you were going to call me in 40 years. Okay. I wanted to come through for you.
You said that was the best time of your life.
Yes.
40 years ago.
Well, 1967, 68.
Yeah, 50 years ago, you peaked?
I peaked with enjoyment. I hadn't started my career yet. But anything, I mean, what's better? I mean, Carnegie Hall, shows, sitcoms, and all that stuff, you know, is that as good as getting loaded and going to see Cream in concert? I don't know. What do I know? You know, but I had a blast, and I got a degree, though, that was in business, you know, and I wound up getting screwed over by 300,000 agents. So the diploma was worthless. I mean, it was really worthless. But, you know, I was, you know, the Wisconsin cat who comes on later, I was just free associating. I used to open up for big celebrities when I was young, and I hated it. I really hated it, like Sonny and Cher. It was frightening. I don't even know how I had enough balls to do it. You know, we were doing 15,000 people in a Madison Square Garden type venues, and I wasn't that well known. And in France, not in Montreal, I was. The guy went, "There's a little Jew down by the." I mean, they had no idea what I was even supposed to do. I thought I was a tumbler, you know, and I. So I got drunk in Montreal, and I had a bad show. And Sonny Bono said, "You were a little loaded, weren't you?" I said, "Yeah, well, you try to do spoken word in front of 20,000 people. Are you out of your mind?" But somehow I pulled it off. So the next time, the last time I ever opened up for a big shot, big celebrity, was in Wisconsin. They had 15,000 people on a hill drinking and eating out of picnic baskets. And, you know, they're making about 200, not that they didn't deserve, like a couple hundred grand a night. I'm getting $500 a week. I had to do a half hour. I was always petrified. I was breaking out. I had rashes growing out of my head like trees. It was horrible. And I always used to go to the venue to see what it was going to be like. So, and Sonny and Cher would get there 5 minutes before and go right on. I'm there an hour before and I'm making $25 or more than that. But, you know, I'm not making much money. So Bono comes in and he says, "Lewis, you're looking at the venue, right?" I go, "Yeah, why are you here? So you don't go on for an hour." He says, "I came here to see the fear in your eyes." And that got me so pissed off that I went on. This is the truth. 15,000 people, I destroyed them. And it was still light out. And that's murder for when you play outdoors. If it's still light out, there's so many distractions. But I destroyed that mountain. And when I walked back to my hotel, I said, "I will never again open up for anyone unless people want to see me." And I never did. And that was like 1977. I said, "I'm not going to be a custodian for anybody. That's that." But at least I went out on decent terms. But that was a scary time. I mean, you had to do everything they threw at you.
If that I take nothing else out of this conversation, it will be, you try to tumble when you're drunk in front of 15,000 people.
Well, I did take an Uta Hagen, she's a tumbling class in Hollywood, and I was a method tumbler. She know I'm a method actor.
Look at the Jew tumble. Come to see Sonny and Cher, but stay for the Jew tumbling.
Don't leave yet. Please don't leave. Lewis will be tumbling right near your seat. So.
Oh my God.
So anyway, I'll let you know when I'm on Curb in December. And but I'm happy to see you and your gang. You know, who came up with Gear Force?
I did.
Was that a dream?
I did. I thought, well, Gear Force, Air Force, yeah, yeah.
So it came to you like the Beatles, like, you know, exactly. Dreams.
I wanted to call it scrambled eggs, as they said, and Paul McCartney came up with Yesterday. He called it scrambled eggs initially, and that's how it started.
You know, I don't even have that.
I don't mean to be drinking in front of you because I know you're.
Oh, no, I have almost 28 years sober. The last thing I will ever do is drink or use again. But I like when people drink. When I go out, when I used to go out and bring people to restaurants, I always felt that they would look at me like, we shouldn't do that. I would order wine and champagne for the table because I'm not a drug cop. I'm just, you know, I was going down. So now I'm alive. It's cool. No, I'm not unhappy about it.
I saw.
What's that picture behind you? It looks. Is that a squid?
No, it's kind of the logo. There's.
That's a logo of your show.
Yeah.
Oh, now I. Oh, the Garry. Oh, the Force.
Yes, be with you. I saw.
I'm very impressed with the introduction. I still can't shake it.
He's very good, Alan. And this is not his
forte.
He was a lawyer. He retired and he dabbles in this, but he's very good at this. And I'm thinking if Saturday Night Live gets a whiff of this, he's gone. He's going to dust me like you wouldn't believe.
He's on the next train to New York, man.
Yeah. And I don't blame him.
Does he take compliments well? My first instinct when I saw him was he wouldn't.
Oh, that's nice. No,
I'm very appreciative. Thanks, Richard. I do appreciate the kind words.
Well, you really do. You're a lucky man that you can. So you don't really battle with low self-esteem then, apparently.
How was that as a Larry David?
What kind of areas disturb you the most?
What's that?
What kind of areas really wreak havoc on your esteem?
I had enough problems practicing law after 20 years that I said enough of that.
Oh, that's nothing. I'm talking about skin and sexuality and intimacy. Never mind. It's a whole other area. When you're talking about a law school, you're lucky. If that's as deep as it gets, you're a lucky man.
Let me ask you this, Richard.
Anything.
Because of the Chappelle thing, and you haven't been on the road for a long time, but it seems like the winds have shifted as far as stand-up comedy. You could really hit a tripwire doing just about anything. And I'm always of the belief that comics should be the people that take all of society's whatever and then put it into their lens and push it out and make it fun. Because just about everything that we have to go through can be a burden. And the comics out there, they're the ones that can make it look like it's not a burden. And now that's a problem.
You know, I don't watch. I never, you know this when I was, working. I stopped 2 years ago after my 50th year. I said, I've had enough. And it was the best tour of my career. And I ended in Chicago and L.A. Because I said, I'm done. I'm done expressing myself. Because I expressed my feelings. I wasn't talking about society as much in politics. I did, but it was mainly about me. It was sort of a self-centered show. But I never used to watch other comics shows. I rarely did, or except they were good friends or specials, because I was purely a very ethical guy, and I didn't want to hear any words that would stick in my brain or premises that might not have even been good, but I could have made better. And so even today, I know this. Some really well-known many. There's a whole slew of great comics and all of the different types, edgy, observational, cheap jokes, thieves. It's just like the old days. It's just there are plenty of good ones. And some people wrote me yesterday or 2 days ago. They said, "Did you see Chappelle's concert?" I said, "You know, I haven't seen the other five." I said, "Why? Why do you want me to see it?" And they said, "Well, you got so much heat." And I knew about the heat. And I watched it last night with my wife, and I don't know what the other five were like. I would imagine it wasn't mostly rapping about, the LGBTQ community and all that. And he must have gone into a lot of subjects. But I felt that he was a master at his craft. I felt that way. I felt that he was very authentic. I wasn't offended. I gathered because I didn't hear the big problems that preceded it, that he was trying in his own comedic style to apologize is the wrong word. I looked at it. I said, I probably should have seen some of his earlier work. I saw his Comedy Central stuff, and a lot of that stuff is brilliant. And so he's capable of being hilarious. But, you know, last night was a different kind of special. It was like, you know, I'm famous. I'm rich. I've been beaten up now. They're punching down on me, and I want to get even. And I didn't find it too nasty. I wasn't offended. And the bottom line is, it's the First Amendment, and no one has to watch anybody. Let alone Dave, although he's a pretty brilliant guy when I've seen parts of his stuff. So, you know, I told the people that called me, I said, I enjoyed it. You know, I didn't find anything offensive. Everybody can find something offensive with almost anybody. Right now, there could be 8 people that want to hang me. I mean, I've said nothing. So, I mean, yeah. It's like when I used to be on Twitter, and I am on Twitter, but I would say something, you know, someone would write, gee, Richard, I don't mean to boast, we've been following you ever since Carson and Letterman, and you helped us through some dark times. And I said, well, thank you. I would write back, thank you very much. And then I would do something about Trump, and the same people would go, you Jew bastard, you know, sort of like,
well, what, yeah, which you know, happened? You know, the tripwires are out there.
Oh, well, yeah.
Let's talk about Curb a little bit here. The theme so far is Larry has a guy that ends up drowning in his pool, and then the person who drowns brother basically blackmails Larry to hire his daughter to be in a show that Larry's producing. And that is that going to be the whole theme for the whole, how many episodes are there this year?
There are 10 episodes. My house would blow up if I even told you, but I knew the outlines a year and a half ago, but I don't know them anymore. Once I knew that I couldn't be in it, I was a little depressed, to be quite frank. So, he is putting on, as of last week, he is putting on this play, and he's trying to, you know, avoid getting, you know, screwed over by that fence that he didn't put around his swimming pool. But, you know, I've seen some episodes and they're hilarious. I mean, what can I say? I mean, he's my oldest friend. We were born in the same hospital. And there's so many, it's all over the world, this show. It's you know, the thing about Larry, which is sort of amazing when you think about it, in our generation and other generations before mine, at least, is that he had Seinfeld and then he backed it up with this. When you think of Norman Lear, you know, he had like 7 things going at once, or guys like Chuck Lorre, he has 29 sitcoms now. So, I mean, but the quality of Norman Lear and Larry is, you can't beat it. He's sort of the Norman Lear of his generation.
It seems to me like Curb is Seinfeld dark, in that Larry can go into areas that they couldn't do on broadcast television. Right. The episode that completely locked me in, as far as Curb goes, his wife's aunt dies.
Yeah.
And Larry is told to put the obituary in for his wife's aunt.
The beloved aunt.
Which he does. And then he comes home as his wife has gathered her relatives, and he walks in and they're all crying looking at the newspaper. This is brilliant, I think. And yeah. What's wrong? What's wrong? And she goes, did you see this? This is the obituary that you sent out. He goes, what's wrong with it? And he reads it, and it's not beloved aunt, it's beloved cunt, because they had a typo and aunt became the C word. Who thinks like this?
No, he's that. What about the survivor? You know, the Holocaust survivor, the guy was just on the TV show Survivor. I mean, he goes dark. He used to be, his stand-up used to be somewhat like this, but he couldn't handle audiences, which is not a good thing if you're a performer. So he basically puts his it's like Woody stopping stand-up when he was young and putting his voice through a lot of characters. And I think Larry does the same in some regard. But, you know, I was just free associating in my mind. I was thinking of one episode that I really liked a lot. It's called the Bracelet. and had a lot of different layers to it, but we wound up helping a blind man move his furniture. And this actor, whose name escapes me, he was a terrific actor. He was, when we took a break and went back to our wagons and there was lunch, he walked around the entire day from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. blind. He was walking into people. He was trying to get his lunch without looking at it, and he was pouring food over people's plates. I said, boy, this is a method actor. This guy really went. He never opened his eyes for 14 hours. But there's been a lot of great episodes. I mean,
it really is. It's classic. I mean, I like that kind of humor, as you know. That's why you and I are friends,
sure.
Because it's not the norm. It's off to the side somewhere, and that's what I like. And your stand-up was not what other stand-ups are doing. That's why I was so fascinated by seeing you the first time. I thought, I've never seen this kind of humor on stage. Because it's really you, and you're filtering all of your maladies and psychosis and everything else into making it some kind of entertainment, which is, it's not as easy as it sounds.
No, I don't know how I did it. I did do that somewhat, and a lot of people would say, hey, I'm nuts too. Thanks a lot. Love you. I mean, that they felt good about what I did. I feel good about the path I chose. And, you know, and I'm able to do that again with Larry. I mean, for 20 years, I've been 12 seasons, but or 11 seasons, but I'm playing me. And it's a little, it's not, it is me. There's no question about it. But Larry puts me in situations where I can humiliate myself. And I like to humiliate him. We just try to humiliate one another all the time. In fact, there's a Jimmy, he was on Jimmy Kimmel 3-4 weeks ago. And it's easy to find. And he was great. And he showed a 28 second clip of the episode that I'm in. And I was shocked.
He wishes you would die, I think, in that.
He said, right. When are you going to die? When are you going to die already? I can't take you. You depressed me. When are you going to die? And Kimmel said, and he said, I was the only person in the world that he could say that to, because we have such a strong friendship. But it was, I don't know what he's going to say. I mean, I just knew we were sitting at this scene, and the only thing we were told that we start talking loudly and argue, action. And then I started mocking him. He started mocking me, and he got so sick of me. He says, when are you going to die already? And it took me by surprise, but it was a great line. I mean, I'll tell you what, this is maybe inside baseball, but there's like a lot of cameras shooting 3 or 4 people at the same time. There's always a camera on an LD. And he's like really, he edits with the editor. He writes with the outline with one or two with the director, and it takes months and months. So when we're shooting, he knows he's doing 3 things at once. One thing he says in his head is, this funny? Will this make the cut? The other thing is, you're getting off the subject. We're wasting our time, and then he thinks about the editing. I mean, this guy's doing 3 things at once. So sometimes if someone gets way off the beaten track, he says, that's the only time we'll get notes. He'll say, don't talk about you went to the circus with your father and your whatever. He says, we don't need it. And he has such a great instinct for what works. So it's really been a trip, man. I mean, I appreciate you liking the show. It's, I always felt, Garry, too, that, I'm like, I didn't want to be liked by everybody. I don't want to be that kind of comedian. I wanted people to go, I don't get him. He's obnoxious. He's neurotic. Or else some people go, God, I love that guy. That's what I always, I think, down deep wanted to be. I didn't want to be liked by everybody. First of all, I couldn't be. And number two, it would mean I would be so bland. We hate those kind of comedians. I don't hate them. I just, who wants to be that way? And I mean, you're one of the most authentic radio personalities ever, because you're you, and you don't want to be bland, and you never were. And
thank you. I appreciate that.
It's true.
I did see your first appearance on Carson, because the Carson show runs on Antenna TV. And several months ago, the episode That was your first appearance on Carson came up. And this is way before I knew you. Even then, you were so unique and had now done something that I had never seen before from a stand-up comic. So I just wanted to put that little compliment on your shoulders. But you are now a man living under the H in Los Angeles of the Hollywood sign.
Yeah.
That's how far you've come. You live near the Hollywood sign, you said, and I said, which letter? And you said H. That's the best neighborhood.
Well, it's true.
Yeah, why is not good? Why is bad?
I did H subconsciously for help. My wife knows that. I always look up there and I see the H and I know that help is on its way. Do I have time for one Carson anecdote?
Yes.
I had this monologue for years on the division of motor vehicles, and it killed. It just killed, and it ran about 5.5 minutes. And I had, you know, when you back in the old days in the 70s, you had to, oh God, you had to go in there with the tape and play it for the talent guy, the coordinator. And then he said, I don't like that joke, and forget another joke. It was just horrible. But you had to go through it before you had a name. So he okayed the Division of Motor Vehicles routine. And I get introduced, and Carson was on, and Burt Reynolds was there. And you know, usually those studio audiences are pretty square, to be frank, in Burbank. But this audience was like me at Town Hall, at Carnegie Hall. I mean, it was almost like they were there to see me. And I was blowing them away with this monologue. And the laughs were so loud and long that I waited for them to dip. And then I went into the next line like a professional should. And midway through the monologue, I had no idea, no sense of time anymore. The stage manager went underneath the camera and I had to make a decision on the spot. If I say goodnight now, midway through this monologue that I crafted for 10 years, I would never get on the show again. I would look like a mental case. So I said, I'd rather kill and go long and never go on again and have people say, why aren't you on with Johnny? I go, I was too good, man. I was just too funny. They don't want me. So I went long. The talent coordinator was screaming at me when I went backstage. He said, you'll never do this show again. And I was like, it was such a weird feeling. I mean, I killed, and yet I can't do the show again. So I used to go to the Palm restaurant after the Tonight Show, and I brought a date with me and my two agents. And I'm sitting there, I'm crestfallen, and I look right across from me, and the chances were 1,000,000,000 to 1, because Johnny lived in Malibu, and this was Hollywood. Carson was there with his lawyer, and I was in shock. I still had the stage makeup on, and Carson did. And when I saw him, I darted over to Carson's booth. And again, the fact that he was at the Palm after the show in Hollywood and not in a home or anywhere, any restaurant, was astonishing. It was a gift from the comedy guards. I ran over to him, and he got, you know, nervous. I got on my knees, and I pleaded my case. And I said, I know I went long. You're a pro. I'm a pro. I couldn't end it in midway. You would have thought I was a moron. And he was just nodding his head. And the next day, I get a call from that loudmouth talent coordinator. He says, you're a lucky man. You can come back whenever you want. And boy, that changed everything. Then from there, I went to Letterman. But I mean, the odds, that was really I had luck, man. I had Carson, I had Dave, I had Jamie Lee Curtis, and then I had you guys. I mean, forget about, you know, you and a lot of radio personalities and other TV shows. But to have then to at 50 get asked by Larry to be on a show, you know, you got to have luck, you know, no matter how good you might be. I had all the luck in the world. And no small thanks to you either, Garry.
Oh, hey, I'm happy to be your friend and promote your deep, lovely comedy that I find so fascinating. And our show this week was talking about some of our favorite Richard Lewis moments. And Leslie said she's very fond of your parents' lovemaking because you would do this bit about your parents. Leslie, why don't you set that up?
Is she going to deliver the punchline? I recall it now.
Wait, Richard's here. Would you do the joke for us? I mean,
the joke is my parents would, were embarrassed for us to hear them screw. And we used to go down there. I used to have like one, like Sherlock Holmes with a horn by the door trying to hear them screwing. I didn't want to see it. I was still a virgin, and I never would have had an erection if I saw it, but I wanted to hear them. So the joke was something like, when my father had an orgasm, he did something like this. He went, oh, that's gin. And that was the gin punchline. It's a 45-year-old joke. Don't hold me to it.
You know what? That's why you're so good, because it's still good when you do the punchline. And the other one that I mentioned was when you referred to your mother as a bowling alley with lipstick.
That's something that I never understood, that people like yourself said, that is so funny. And that was just an image I had, because she was so loud. When we went to any restaurant, she wanted to be the center of attention. And she would walk in and so embarrass me, go, you know, Aunt Faye has a rash on her thigh. And you know, she has gonorrhea. And I go, shut up. What are you doing? So I just imagine a bowling alley with lipstick. It means nothing except the people is
no,
as
no. Black the image you, is, Garry. It's dead on. And The other one was when you came to this nightclub I was invested in. You walked in, you looked around for about 30 seconds, and you said to me, "This looks like a gay shipwreck." And really,
hey, don't get me in trouble. I would go on a gay shipwreck in a minute.
No, I took it as a compliment. I think we need more gays in the mix, because otherwise it's a very drab existence. But it had billowy fabric under the lights, and you just said gay shipwreck. And I'm thinking, that's good.
I meant that in the nicest artistic way.
Yes, I took it that way.
I hope so.
Oh, God. Wow, you're amazing. I love you so much.
I love you, too. And when I get better, I'll come back and be better.
All right. Well, we'll see you in December on Curb, and I'll have you.
I'll let you know when I'm on the week before.
Yeah, maybe I'll talk about that. Yeah.
How do I leave you? I press something?
I can kick you out of the studio if you want that, Richard.
You could do that, because the dressing room sucked. There was no food or anything.
I know this virtual green room stuff just isn't what you're used to. I'm sorry.
No, it was like I felt like I was a prisoner of war, to be frank. But anyway, it's great to meet all you guys. Richard. Garry, I love you, and good luck with the show. And I'll be watching and listening. And I'll speak to you soon. Love to the three girls.
Thank you.
Is your dog a girl?
It's a male. He's a male.
Boy. I wouldn't let him near my daughter. Was he fixed?
No.
You're kidding.
No.
God, so he's like a rapist?
Okay. And on that note.
All right, take care of yourselves.
Richard. Okay.
Bye-bye.
Oh, my God. I have so many moments with him, hanging out with him, and I'm thinking, this is one of the great moments of what I do when I get to meet people like that and hang out with them. That's it to me. That's the whole monkey trick.
Well, and the fact that this has evolved too, to an actual friendship, which is just kind of cool too, because it is funny, but I think you guys are wired very similarly, if you don't mind me saying so.
Well,
hey, before it gets too late, Can we set up a, no, well, it's never too late. We can go as long as we want. We don't have some stage manager doing this to us. But should we set up the giveaway?
Yes, we have
And I'm thinking like maybe hashtag Curb in honor of Richard today. But we're back to giving away a Gear Force scarf and a wine condom, kids. So if you want to start logging in, and of course, this is chosen by the computer. We have no control over the giveaway.
Hashtag Curb. Put that in there. And yes, the computer will pick in a few minutes the winner of the condom and the scarf. Yes.